So if you want to turn to John chapter 4, that's where we're going to be tonight. And I titled the message, Satisfaction Guaranteed. And if you think about it, satisfaction doesn't come naturally. That it's what our entire culture is built upon, the idea that you should be dissatisfied until you get certain things added to your life. It's called the greener grass syndrome. And it says, whatever happiness is, that's where I am not. So I've got to be wherever happiness is. I need satisfaction. And people get in and out of relationships because of it. Advertisers are banking on our dissatisfaction. In fact, millions, if not billions of dollars are poured into marketing research to make Americans unhappy and simply discontent with their lives until you buy their product. And, you know, we see those commercials, we see those infomercials, and they have this in mind. So if you listen to one long enough, say it's a sleepless night, or you're watching these crazy commercials about the best vacuum in the world. You got to have this vacuum for $79 payments. It can be yours. And, you know, I used to scoff at these things. And who buys this stuff? Well, about, you know, 7-8 years ago, I was sick. I just wasn't doing really well. Wasn't sleeping at night. And I remember watching those infomercials. And I remember ordering the ladder. Okay, that went back. I ordered a few other things, and Julie, my wife, said, what is this? I go, it's a ladder that does everything. We can throw all our other ladders away. We have this one ladder. She goes, but we already have ladders, but not like this. And so I was drawn in, and I think some of us have gone through that as well, bought things that you really don't need, which really brings us to our text tonight. We encounter in John chapter 4 a woman, a gal that meets Jesus who has pretty much given up on the fact of ever being happy again. She is hardened by her circumstances. By the time she meets Jesus, she has a ragged edge to her. And we will see that in our text. So we're going to pick up at John 4. We're going to start with chapter 1 and also have a map, which I'll call for in just a moment. So John 4, starting with verse 1. When therefore the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself was not baptizing, but his disciples were, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. Now, I just want to say something here real quick before we move on to the next verse. These first three verses actually have to do with the previous chapter, but I thought I would get a running start into it and start with verse 1. Now, look at verse 4. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave his son Joseph, verse 6. And Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, was sitting thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. It would have been about noon. So now I'm going to bring a map up here for you all to see. And he says he had to pass through Samaria. Now, this was the shortest route from Judea to Galilee, but not the only way. In fact, the other route was through Perea, and of course, that would be the green part right here. Perea, do it over here as well. My hands shake a little bit, but there it is. You see Perea over here? Perea. And it was east of the Jordan River, and so you can see the two routes there. And in Jesus' day, because of their hatred for the Samaritans, normally took the eastern route. Normally they would go through Perea to avoid Samaria. So just keep that up for a little bit longer. But Jesus chose the route directly through Samaria in order to reach these despised people of the day, according to the Jews. And so, as the Savior of the world, he seeks and saves those who are despised, those who are outcast, but he needed to go through Samaria. So he comes to the city of Samaria, again, which is called Sychar. Can you see it up there on the map? It's near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph, and we'll talk about what that is about in just a moment. And Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, is sitting by the well. Okay. So John chapter 4, verse 7, look what it says there. Then he came to a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, I wish I knew tones. I wish I could pick up tones, you know, because you don't always know their tone of voice, how it might be going. But he says, give me a drink. And I don't think it was, give me a drink. You know, I don't think it was like that at all. I think it was, you know, he's weary. He says, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Now, I believe Jesus needed a one-on-one introductory meeting without his disciples around, because they too would have had those built-in cultural prejudice, and it probably would have thrown everything off, because they're, first of all, he's talking to a woman, he's talking to a Samaritan, and it just would have been crazy. Look at verse 9. The Samaritan woman therefore said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, since I am a Samaritan woman? And then John adds this, for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. I mean, none. And not only that, by tradition, rabbis would not speak to women in public. In fact, they wouldn't even speak to their wives in public. It was just something of their culture. They wouldn't do that. So it was also very unusual for a Jewish person of that time to ask a favor or accept a drink from a Samaritan's cup. And Jesus' request, I believe, surprised the woman. I mean, she is surprised. Jesus was a rabbi. He would have looked like a rabbi. He would have had all the garb. And the woman would have probably been impressed by the friendliness of Jesus. And this was probably the first time that she had ever heard a kind greeting from a Jewish man. So I'm sure it totally threw her completely off. Look at verse 10. Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. I like her response here in verse 11. She said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get this living water? You are not greater than our father Jacob, are you? Oh, yes, he is. Who gave us the well and drank it of himself and his sons and his cattle. Now, again, looking at tone, it's hard to tell if the woman is asking a sincere question or if she's kind of being cynical about this right now. And of course, remember, it's noon. Most people don't go to the well at this time of the day. They go early in the morning, late at night. It's extremely hot, so she's probably going at noon to avoid other people because of her reputation. So again, it all depends on the tone in her voice, but look at verse 13. Jesus answered and said to her, everyone who drinks of this water, pointing to the well, shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. Now, I love this because this really can kind of help us when we're in the world, among the world, and talking to people that don't know Jesus. But he draws her into this conversation, making her curious about the things of God. He doesn't shove it down her throat. He talks about God. He talks about the Messiah and what he can give her. And our witness should always be warm and friendly and genuine, because you know what? The world picks up when we're hypocritical. They pick it up. They know when we are not sincere. Now, sometimes we're out there and we just want to win converts, and it's great. They need to be saved. They need to have eternal life. But sometimes we need to be a friend first, earn their trust, and then go for the jugular. Okay. but sincerely, really trying, people can pick it up when you're not. They can pick it up. You know what I'm talking about. So what Jesus was promising this woman was an unlimited resource that will never run out. That's why I titled it, Satisfaction guaranteed. But this gal is not thinking about spiritual water. She's thinking about this literal running spring that bubbles up without having to draw from it. And boy, that would make her life so much easier. But Jesus is wanting to quench her spiritual inward thirst. It's not a physical condition. It's not an emotional or psychological condition, but it's an inward spiritual condition. She needs to have that quenched. And it doesn't come from having things. It doesn't come from not having things. You know, because we try to fill our lives with all kinds of things, and they don't satisfy us. They don't fulfill us. Maybe they do in the moment. But the fact of the matter is everybody has this need. Everybody wants this. It's a deep human need. It doesn't matter your age, your gender, your economic status. It's a universal need, and many people are not aware of it. In fact, when I'm talking to somebody about the Lord, I'm very aware of that. I'm very aware of it. It's actually kind of comforting to know that need is there. It doesn't mean they're going to reveal that to you right then and there. I have a need. My heart is empty, but it's there. It is there for sure. Now, that's why John stated in John 4:4, and he had to pass through Samaria. It was not a place anybody would want to go if you were Jewish. I just want to say that again. Now, I've got to tell you why John brings this up, why Jews back then had no dealings with Samaritans. You need to know why, maybe you already know why, but let me tell you. Although the road to Samaria was the shortest route to Galilee, most Jews avoided it. They didn't even want their foot to step on their soil. I mean, on Samaritan soil. They didn't. They made a point to go around, take the long way. It didn't matter. They avoided it because there was a deep distrust and dislike between Jews and Samaritans. What happened is when the southern kingdom of Judah was conquered by the Babylonians, well, they took many people captive, and they took the cream of the crop, so to speak, of Israel. They took the Daniels, they took the Meshachs, the Shadrachs, the Abednegoes, and they stripped them of all these people and their land, and they left behind, in Babylonians' opinion, they left behind the lowest of class of society there, and they didn't want that type in their society in Babylonia. And of course, they left them there, they intermarried with other people, and they slowly came to this region, and the Samaritans emerged, and it was this ethnic and religious group. Now, because the Samaritans had a historical connection to the people of Israel, their faith was kind of a combination of the law, of ritual from the Old Testament. Also, they had their false religion, they had their superstitions, and it was all mixed into this weird view mindset that this woman had. So most Jews in Jesus' time despised the Samaritans even more than Gentiles. They'd talk to a Gentile before they talk to a Samaritan. And the reason is they looked at the Samaritans as these, I quote, you know, half-breeds who had a diverse mixed faith. In fact, in the book of Nehemiah, some of the Samaritans wanted to help to rebuild rebuild when the Jews returned from Jerusalem, about 50,000 of them. And the Jews in Judea said, "No way, you are not going to help us. You are not allowed." So the animosity was so diverse that in 330 BC, the Samaritans built this rival temple at Mount Gerizim, right where Jesus is right now. Right above the setting was this temple at Mount Gerizim. It was a rival worship system. They made their own stories about Abraham coming there to offer Isaac instead of in Jerusalem. They had their own priesthood. So you can kind of see why they felt the way they did. It kind of reminded me of a lot of churches today who claim that many roads lead to God with the denial or lack of recognition of the cross of Christ. You notice that? You notice that even in churches? But a lot of Christian religion and rhetoric is a mix of the gospel. Sometimes you have some cultic stuff in there. You have cultural preferences that are contrary to God's word, and that's what we see in our day and age. So why did Jesus have to pass through Samaria? Same reason why he came to each and every one of us. with a mixed up view, maybe with a messed up life, because there was a woman and a city that needed to hear the truth. So John wants us to know that Jesus needed to go through Samaria because the people in Samaria needed to hear the gospel as much as the people in Judea. Because if you look at the chapter beforehand, Jesus is in Judea. He's talking to one of the main guys, Nicodemus, and witnessing to him, and he doesn't get it either. It kind of goes over his head, just like it does with this woman, but now he's in Samaria. Again, look at John 4, 6. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sitting thus by the well, it was about the sixth hour. Again, it was about noon. So think about this. Jesus is tired. Jesus is weary from his journey. He sits down by this well, and he was truly human. He experienced thirst, weariness. He experienced pain. He experienced hunger. Of course, he possessed all the attributes of deity. He was 100% man, and he was 100% God. He was God in the flesh. He was Emmanuel. And it puts a little bit more of, I really appreciate, I'll give you one scripture to write down if you're taking notes. It's Hebrews 4:15. You don't need to turn there. But Hebrews 4:15 really comes alive because it says, this high priest of ours, and I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation, of ours, understands our weaknesses. For he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it the most. Jesus understands our shortcomings. He understands the human aspect of who we are. He gets it. So we can go boldly. Lord, you know what's going on in my life right now. You know how I feel. It might be loneliness. It might be some kind of pain. It could, you know, Jesus understands. He came here. He experienced those things. So here it is. It's the hottest part of the day. A woman of Samaria comes out to draw the water, probably hoping nobody's around. And Jesus says to her, give me a drink. So on one hand, Jesus needed to go through Samaria, but in doing so, he was weary from the journey. So here you have Christ, you have Jesus tired while he's serving others. It just that dawned on me. He was always surrounded with people. The crowds were pressing in around him. He worked at night. He had long hours. And when he was alone with his disciples, he had to mentor them. Can you imagine mentoring that group of guys? It's a full-time job. So he was always around. Once in a while, he got away to be by himself, but it was very rare. And then when he'd come down, hey, the whole world's looking for you, Jesus. Where have you been? The point I want to make is that Jesus reaches out to people even when he was on the edge of physical exhaustion. I really appreciate that. I believe much of ministry is done by tired people. I think I'm looking at a few of them tonight. The best sermons are preached by the tired and weary. The best camps are run by the exhausted youth pastors and their teams. Just talk to them after camps. The third world is being evangelized by tired missionaries. The Christian organizations of our world are being run by tired men and women. Sometimes that's when God uses us, is when we're at the end of ourselves. He does some great and mighty things because our strength is run out, and now we're walking in his strength. Amen? I mean, I don't always want to be tired. I mean, I have to get a five-hour energy every once in a while, or those other things, that those monster, I don't drink those monster drinks, by the way. I just drink the little one. But we're tired. A lot of us are exhausted from work, from school, from kids, whatever your life might be. Single, married, your life can be exhausted. So now it's a simple conversation, and Jesus begins with a simple request. Give me a drink. Then he moves quickly, he moves the conversation to a deeper spiritual level. All the while that he's doing that, this whole concept of the spiritual level, this metaphor of this living water goes right over her head. She doesn't get it. Nicodemus, who was the teacher of Israel, who was a very wealthy and powerful man, he didn't get it either. And he knew the law. He knew the word. When Jesus says you must be born again, he said, wait a minute, I have to enter my mother again and come out a second time. He didn't get it. It just whooshed right over his head as well. So this woman is in the same boat, except she's a Samaritan. Now, there's something that would help us at this point. 2,000 years ago in the Jewish vernacular, you know what living water was? It was nothing more than flowing water. It was the contrast to water in the well where Jesus is at with her, collected by rain, or it was water on the move, a stream of water. It was living water. So that's what she is thinking of. So keep that in mind. Jesus is meaning it spiritually, but she's taking it very, very literally. Like she's saying, yeah, where's the stream? Tell me where the stream is. I want to know where the stream is. It would sure make my life a lot easier. Maybe I wouldn't be around so many people. But she doesn't get what Jesus is saying to her. And Jesus is God, and she doesn't get it. That's actually good news, because it's the Lord who has to reveal these things to people. You know how you try to have this conversation with somebody and you think they're getting it? Well, I'm getting ahead of myself now. But now what she reveals is the condition, I believe, of every human heart. And here it is. People are massively thirsty, but they either don't or won't admit it. They won't admit it. And many of them, frankly, don't even realize it yet. They are not even in touch with that need. And so be patient with your friends, with your family, with your coworkers. I mean, just remember, if Jesus got a hold of you, he can get a hold of them. Amen? It's his work. So now, that is typically of the condition of people we meet today. We live in a culture that is a post-Christian culture. Things have become mechanical, and we, our society, like the Samaritans, have blended. Think about this. We have blended our beliefs with our fallen mindsets, leaving no room for the authentic, and people are confused. You believe that? But what about this? What I can't stand is those bumper stickers that have every religion on it. You ever see those? They got the cross, the star, and then all those other weird-looking things on there, and it's like coexist or something like that. I don't like that. I'm glad I don't have anything on my car that could aim at them or something like that. But they don't know yet. I mean, the Lord's still working on their hearts, and hopefully they'll know. But you see those, right? You see those. We seem to be more focused on being politically correct. I hate that word. Intolerant. And ironically, Jesus and the gospel is nothing but tolerant with grace. But the world can't see it. They want us to be tolerant, but then when we do something, they're not tolerant with us. It's not fair, but that's the world. In fact, one of the most famous scriptures that we see everywhere, football games, basketball games, is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And here it is. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That is the gospel. I love it. The Lord wants to reach out to everybody. Everybody. Have you ever shared with somebody the gospel and they don't get it? Anybody ever shared the gospel with somebody? Probably almost all of our hands would go up. They don't see it. You've labored. The way you talked about it, you've prayed about it, and your witness is there, and you're thinking, this is good. This is so good. I'm saying my words right. They seem to be listening. They're giving me that nod. Oh, wow, this is good. They're close. They're so close. But then you see, they don't get it. You talk about maybe the surrendered life and giving your life to Jesus, and all of a sudden it's like, what? It goes right over their head. And really, what I believe it is it's a battle of knowledge versus knowing. It's a battle of knowledge versus knowing. And there's a big difference there. A lot of them have knowledge. A lot of them have more knowledge than a lot of us Christians. They know things that we don't know. They've studied. They have the knowledge, but they don't know. They don't know the Lord personally. But we shall see that the Samaritan woman will get it at the end of the day. But like with everyone, it's a process and it's the Lord's work. It's not ours. Now, I do want to tell you something. It's kind of bad news. It's not bad news, actually, but I just need to tell you this ahead of time. We won't get to the end of the story. It just won't happen because of time, but we're going to get through a lot of it, but I'll just tell you, she gets it at the end of the day. It's pretty cool. Now look at John 4:13. And Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst." The first part of verse 14, listen to it out of the New Living Translation. "But those who drink the water that I will give will never thirst again." Let me say that again. "But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again." You could take verse 13, the verse right before it, as a banner statement to write above every earthly pursuit. Now I want you to think of things, every earthly pursuit. There's earthly pursuits. We all have them. We're all involved in some kind of earthly pursuit. It doesn't mean it's evil, but it's an earthly pursuit. And think about this. Every earthly pursuit short of Christ, you could write over that pursuit, "Drink this water, the well water, and you'll thirst again." You could write that over every earthly pursuit. And I got a few examples. "Well, if I only had that right person to marry..." You're awful quiet, okay? We have singles here. I'm not saying if you're single, you want to be married. Some of you are like, "Thankful, I'm single, and I don't want to be married." No, thank you, okay? Some of you are single thinking, I would like that. Some of you are married and going, So, you know, again, sometimes, you know, the singles want to be married, the marrieds don't want to be married, you know, because that satisfaction thing, of, wow, this is not what I thought it was going to be, stepping on toes now all over the place, it's happening. But really, drink of this water and you will thirst again. That's an earthly pursuit. Here's another one. "If only I made some more money, if only I had a better job, drink of this water, the well, and you will thirst again." I'm thinking, Lord, if I had more money or got some inheritance from somewhere, I don't know where it would come from, I could just do so much for the kingdom. That's something I used to say. And, you know, I would hope I would do that. But again, drink of this water and you'll thirst again. And of course, God uses a lot of people in this way. How about this one? "Oh, if I could just live in a better neighborhood." "Drink of this water and you'll thirst again." I mean, some people, they call your neighborhood the ghetto. You know, you live in the ghetto. You know, if you live over this way, the ghetto. I live over here, the ghetto. I mean, who knows what's the ghetto and what's not the ghetto. But you know what it really comes down to? It's just not being satisfied where you're at. I would rather be over there with those people or over there with those people. That's a nicer. The crime rate is lower and there's not all these people begging on the streets. And I get, you know, all kinds of things go through your head and everything. But again, just remember what Jesus is doing. He's going through Samaria. So only Jesus is capable of fulfilling our lives through and through so we can enjoy the externals of life. Because Jesus is not against the externals of life. But if our pursuit is just that, we're going to come up empty. John 4:14, the second part of that verse. "But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." Now, this is the living water. This is the stream of water that bubbles up continually. And that's what Jesus is focusing on with this woman. It's within you. That's because when Christ is within you, you receive Christ, you ask Jesus Christ into your life, he comes within you, and that is the source of life, is Jesus Christ within you. That is the living water that's where it comes from. How did I come to know the Lord? I heard some people talking about it on TV, heard a few preachers say about Jesus. I wasn't ready yet. It was a knowledge issue. I had this knowledge, but I didn't have this knowing, and all of a sudden I realized I had this hole in my heart, and I just asked Jesus to come into my life. I didn't get saved at church. I got saved in my bedroom. The only one who knew about it was my mom, who was a fanatical Christian. And she goes, "I've been praying for you, and now you're saved, and hallelujah." She was, you know, charismatic. That was my, and I love her. Well, she's with the Lord now. But I just remember thinking, stay away from me. You know, she used to just freak me out, speaking in tongues and all that stuff. And And I thank God. I thank God for tongues and all that stuff. But I just remember being freaked out about that because my mom was such a zealot, and it just freaked me out, and I was the next one to come to know the Lord. I realized that hole in my heart. And of course, if that's something you realize, whether it's tonight, when you get home, tomorrow, I mean, today is the day of salvation, to always remember you can call on the name of the Lord. So it's within you. You don't have to keep looking from without. On the outside, the search is over. You have the spring of living water if you have Jesus. Here's where I want to get to. Here's where I want to get to toward the end. I'm a Christian, Paul, and I haven't been satisfied. I haven't been refreshed. I feel more like a well of stagnant water. I get that. I've been there. Some of you might be there tonight. You have asked Jesus into your life. You know the Lord. You love the Lord. But your life is stagnant right now for whatever reason. Maybe it's not. If it were just a well, you could cover it up. Think about that for a moment. You could cover it up. If it's a spring, you can't really cover it up. If it's a well, you can put dirt in it and nobody sees it. Okay, if it's a well that just collects water. But if it's a spring, you could cover it up with dirt if it was a spring, but eventually it's going to reveal itself because it's a spring. It's coming up. Here's the problem. Water's going to keep coming up. And sometimes believers try to cover up the spring with the externals of life, the distractions of life. And all you do when you put mud over a spring of living water, a spring, is you just make a muddy mess. Are some of you a muddy mess? I know what it's like to be a muddy mess. And sometimes that happens. We're just a muddy mess. Why? Because there is a spring. Jesus is there. He's within us. We're covering it up. Things are distracting us. Maybe our home life. Maybe our marriage. Maybe your singleness. Whatever is going on. And that well is there. It's there. And I'll tell you, if it's a spring, it's going to reveal itself. So when all the while, this is what the Lord wants for us, for all of us. He wants us to be drinking deeply from that spring. Get back to that spring. Go back to Him. Drink deeply from Him. And taste that satisfied life again. And it could be that some of you have just made a mess of your lives. I mean, we could blame the devil. You know, but you've made the mess. I've made the mess. This is my doing. Yeah, He's out there to tempt me, but I have the power of the Holy Spirit, and I can overcome these things, but I choose not to for whatever reason, discouragement, what it might be. But you've made a mess of your lives, and you simply just need to get back to Him. And this is what I thought about this. When we get still, there's that psalm that says, "Be still and know that I am God." Because sometimes we're wondering, what do I do to get back? How do I get back? Sometimes, to get back to God, you just be still. Don't try to work your way back. Don't try to earn your way back. Don't try to be good enough, you know, so He'll accept you. But you're already His because He will never leave you or forsake you, right? You're already His if you called on the name of the Lord. But when you get still and know that He is God, the dirt settles, the water clears up, becomes pure and satisfying to drink. And sometimes maybe that's exactly what the Lord wants for you tonight. Is child, daughter of God, son of God, you know, sons and daughters of God. I just want you to be still right now. And let me just speak into your heart. You've been wounded, maybe you've been hurt, maybe you're on the mountaintop right now, great. But the Lord wants you just to be still so that spring will reveal itself because He dwells within us. The spring will clear up, you'll be able to drink from it again. Let the Lord lead you. And I want to close with Psalm 34, 8. And it says this. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who take refuge in Him. Let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful that You are incredibly patient with us. Some of us have been covering up the spring We know you. You know us. Maybe we started off really strong. Maybe something came and just sideswiped us and just took us off balance. And we haven't been the same since. But that spring is there because you said that you would never leave us. You would never forsake us. And yes, it might be a muddy mess right now. But the mud just reveals that the spring is there. So Lord, with our hearts just coming before you right now, and as we get ready to worship, Lord, this is not just a night to come during the midweek. This is a meeting with you. And as we have this time together, Lord, that our hearts would just be pliable and even broken before you, that we would again be still and to hear your voice, hear the voice of your word, and let that spring start to rise up again within us and drink from that clear and pure water. Thank you, Lord, that we would just look past the mud. We'd let you do the work. As your sheep, you are our shepherd, and you gracefully lead us in paths of righteousness for your sake. Lord, we surrender now with all that we have, all that we do. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.